Hello, and welcome back to another episode of Critical Reactions with your host, Brian. We've only got two more of these special selections to go. Well, actually, I guess until the weekend when we do two more. So let's see what the rest of this weekend brings us. Sorry, the rest of this week brings us. Jake Rushing says, Player Institute Support Channel, I'd love to see either the Mars Volta, or Between the Buried and Me. Whatever you're more in the mood for. Keep up the great reactions. Hopefully my lack of being able to speak is not a bad omen for the rest of this video. So as you can see from the video, I picked Mars Volta on the strict basis that Between the Buried and Me is something I think I really need to experience with full albums, especially since I think that song he requested comes off of one of the concept albums. I think that's what I learned when I looked it up, trying to figure out which one of these to pick. So we went with Mars Volta, which might be a bad choice because it's 17 minutes almost. So, grab some water, grab a snack or some food, get comfy. We got a long track ahead of us. This is Mars Volta's Tetragrammaton. Starting strong. Very chaotic, though. Not necessarily in rhythm, but in musical ideas. Those lengthy snare fills, though. Really interesting choice. Especially how frequently they're being used. Lots of little moments of dissonance, too. And the panning here. The call and response moving in opposite panning. That's interesting. Dude, the vocal work is gorgeous. Alright, starting in the end of that beat, of that bar. Interesting transition. Yeah, those ghost notes into that snare run is just... Not many people will stay in the snare that long. Yeah. The layering here is gorgeous. That offbeat one, got me again. Really expecting that strong downbeat entrance. We got some reverse tracking going on. These transitions are killing me. Bit of a flamenco feel in the guitars. Not really anything else, just the guitars. Bass really holding this section down, being the only moving aspect. These guys did have weird atmospheric stuff last time we checked them out too, didn't they? I thought we were going somewhere pretty cool, and then the song disintegrated. Rhythmic synergy going on underneath the solo. Dang, adding that extra beat there. Yeah, so three bars of four and then one bar of five. at just the dissonance on this guitar work. It's almost like it's achordal, just kind of playing whatever it wants. Mixed with the sharp atmospheric work in the other ear. It's so confusing because there's this really strong groove underneath all this, but there's a lot of chaos at the top too. Yeah, harmonized falsettos. I think that's the first transition I've enjoyed. That was pretty good though. Just the tonal entropy that the guitar in this ear has been doing for like the past 3 minutes. Alright, these transitions are getting better. It's really interesting the textural aspects that are going on here, and it sounds like these instruments are sort of merging into single sounds and then slowly getting out of that overlap. Sometimes it's really difficult to figure out where one voice begins and another ends. Thank you. Ooh, now see, that was a clean transition. That fade and wah pedal. So here on the channel, I like to pride myself in finding the positives to talk about almost any song that's been thrown at me. I am definitely not one to shy away from criticism, negative criticism, I will say, about some of the music we've listened to, but I do try to at least walk away with one positive thing to say about everything we listen to. Y'all are trying me on this one. I kid. There's actually a lot of positive things, but it is a very difficult song to listen to, at least for me. And that's because I would definitely place this into more of an experimental or avant-garde area where everything that I typically congratulate bands for is thrown out the window and purposely created against. Anything that would be, you know, a good rule of writing good music, I put that in quotations because there's no such thing as good music and there's no rules to writing music. But the typical ideas that we have for good music, so to speak, in at least the Western world, this sort of just doesn't do any of that. There's certainly some ideas in here. I think that the main chorus, if we could call it that, it's repeated twice. It comes around three times. So I think it's the closest thing to a chorus we could have in this track. I think the vocals are a bit catchy. The shrill, almost shrill falsetto probably isn't for everyone. But I think if we brought it down an octave or gave it to somebody whose range they could get up there with more of a chest or mixed voice, I think we could turn that into a very catchy hook. That's about the only thing I can say in this song that kind of meets modern ideas of beautiful music writing. And as I mentioned earlier, there's no way to write good music. Just because it sounds beautiful to our ears today doesn't mean that it is beautiful music in the larger scheme of things. So that is not a slight against them, that there's only one thing I could say that works well with modern composition technique. But it also means that I have a lot of, I'm going to have a lot of difficulty piecing together a lot of positive stuff here, because this song does go against everything that I typically praise. So instead, I'm going to just talk about some of the things that kind of stick out to me, and we'll see if I can work it into some sort of idea of positivity. At least in my mind, I have a ground for a neutral analysis of this. I will preface, though, I did not enjoy the song. Not on a casual listening, not on a semi-purely analytical listening, but I do appreciate the track, which I've said many times before when we look at more experimental avant-garde stuff. I do appreciate it, all right? And I will get to that later. There's a lot of things that I think are really interesting in the track, and the way that it is composed and the way that it all comes together, even if I don't necessarily enjoy listening to it. But if there's one phrase I could say to wrap this entire song up into, it is orchestrated entropic cacophony. The song seems to be created with the express intent of 16 minutes of mostly what I would describe to most people would be nails on a chalkboard. Not everybody's going to listen to this and get that reaction. I am just not a big fan of extended amounts of dissonance. I think it can be used well. It, like anything else, it's a tool in the toolbox. I'm not saying you can't be dissonant for, you know, long periods of time and not... I'm not saying that you can't use dissonance for long periods of time and still end up with, you know, a bad song, so to speak. Bad song. Let me put the quotes up. But this song specifically, it's almost 16 minutes of dissonance. And the thing is that the dissonance seems to be a layer on top of a song that is fairly funky. There's a lot of groovy sections in here that I enjoy, but that have like a secondary set. It's like they recorded a really groovy track and then put dissonance on top of it. The dissonance rarely fits in with the music that's going on underneath it. And I do mean underneath it. There seems to be prominence given to the more dissonant sections, the atonal sections, the ones that are working with what I would say would be a chromatic scale. Whereas the rest of the song seems to fit within a standard chord progression, we have usually an instrument, given spotlight in the mix, playing either achromatically or purposefully drawing outside the lines of the chords that are being utilized in the core part of the song, the groovy part of the song. And in essence, like I said, there's a couple of sections that feel like it's a really groovy track, and then they said, hey, we want this to sound nails on a chalkboard. And they put this extra part in it to literally just create that dissonance, that grinding. At least that's how I view it in the mix. Maybe that's not how they went about it, but that's what it feels like in the mix to me. And that's only really the chorus and a couple of sections. Not many, though. Really just the chorus. A lot of the rest of the song tends to just have chaos and dissonance built into it. But really that chorus is what brings it out. And I think it's because we listen to it so many times that it's just really prominent. You can hear the song in both speakers, both, you know, sides of the headphone. But then in the left side, well, to you it looked like this. There is just a guitar screeching away with a ton of prominence, just playing notes that do not fit with that song that's going on underneath it. And it just seems like such a conscious decision, and it's the two parts just feel so disjointed. But at the same time, like I said, that's really the only section I feel that. The rest of the track just kind of has dissonance built into it. And cacophony and chaos and whatever other descriptive word, adjective you want to put in there. The song is just, it wants to deliver that. cringiness, like so many parts of this song just made me want to like curl up, get goosebumps, the shivers up my spine, just because of the way that dissonance is just employed liberally everywhere. It purposely exists as a song to buck the idea of harmony. At least it feels like that to me. We've checked out at least one Mars Volta song before. Oh, it must have been two, because I recognize this album art here. I don't know. Maybe I recognize that album art because of it's one of the... I don't know. Did we do a Cygnus, Visman Cygnus? That sounds familiar. But it also might be an upcoming special section. But also, I remember a live track, an actual music video, checking them out. And so we've checked them out a couple of times. I know that they can do sort of, not necessarily beautiful would be the right word for it, but interesting, harmonious jam sessions. So I know that they're not an untalented group that accidentally just had no idea how to compose this song. All of that it's done with purpose. But what I want to point out is that they are a band that has always dealt with musical chaos. We've checked out a few songs recently, where I've mentioned that the layering work is really well done. And this is sort of the antithesis to that. The layering work here is not there to promote any sort of order. It doesn't allow the instruments to, pass on the spotlight between each other so that everybody gets a chance. Whatever sound is most important for that beat or bar gets the spotlight in the mix. The composition itself has instruments stepping on each other's toes. Some people are playing notes against other people's notes that are creating dissonance, that's just rubbing the wrong way. Sometimes we get lines that really do not deserve the importance they're getting in the mix. They're higher up in the mix than what I would assume would be more of a melody line. And it's causing this clash because your ears are being, drawn to what I would say is a supporting line. And there's just a lot of movement on so many beats. So many bars have multiple voices with tons of movement in them. And it ends up feeling jumbled and chaotic. And I don't know how many times I can say this, but chaos is just baked into this song. There's just so many sections that feel chaotic. And that's kind of what I'm kind of learning about Mars Volta, at least the tracks we've checked out from them thus far, is that they really know how to revel in that. They make their songs feel very full. And chaotic, definitely. There is a sort of entropic appreciation to their work. It's not something you're going to find in a lot of other bands or songs, is their willingness to overload moving lines. And the weird thing is, I want to say it here too, it's bad composition. It really is. But coming at it from an artistic point of view, sort of an avant-garde experimental idea, if this is what you want, you're not really going to find it anywhere else. Not on this level of expertise. I think it's really easy to create a song that's too chaotic, there's too much stuff going on in it, but it's really difficult to make that sound listenable. And I think that's kind of what these guys' strong suit is knowing how much is too much. They definitely overload the soundscape. There is too much. It's bursting through. They really fill up every empty space of the sound that they can. But at the end of the day, aside from a lot of the dissonance, the chaos is listenable. At least in the more traditional parts, like the chorus section that I've talked about a couple of times. We're not talking about the atmospheric sections or any of the more interesting texture ideas that they have going on. But when we look at some of the more typical rock ideas that just have a lot of layers going on them, They tend to still create a rather listenable rock feel, even though it is just to the brim with chaos. There's just so much going on. And I think that's a real unique skill. I don't know if they get a lot of praise for that, but I will give them a lot of praise for that. It is not an easy thing to do, to know when too much, or, you know, when you've hit a level of too much and that you really can't add anything else without taking away a huge level of listenability to the section that you're writing. Now, with that said, that is pretty much my critique on the more rock styled sections. They have a completely other side to this song, which I would say is atmospheric. It's highly experimental. This is definitely where the avant-garde aspects come in. They are playing around with textures and tones and all sorts of modulation. There's a lot of deterioration effects. A few of these sections, I would say, enter into the realm of psychedelic avant-garde, where they are creating auditory soundscapes of what it's like to not be in a coherent mindset. Maybe that's due to mental illness or drug use or something that's causing you to understand the world in an unusual manner. And that's kind of the idea that I get through a lot of these atmospheric sections, especially when they start playing around with panning and when they start deteriorating tones and just messing with tone textures. There are a couple sections in here where multiple instruments were modulated so far that they sounded identical. They had very, very, very similar timbres, and they would sort of use intonation to line them up, and I really couldn't tell which instrument was which. I think this specifically happened with like violin and vocals, I think, at one point. And then he would get slowly out of tune. And, I'd be like, oh, you know, now I can hear some of the more nuanced aspects of these two voices and really hear them. But then they phase back into like pure intonation where they're very, very in tune. And it sounds like one, they're merging timbres. What in the world? It's a weird metamorphosis of texture and timbre and stuff going on, and it's interesting. I will say that. Once again, it's one of those things that I don't really think you could get anywhere else. If that's what you want, Mars Volta is going to be the best band in the world, because I don't know who else is going to deliver on that, but also who's going to deliver on that in tandem with the other chaos that they introduce into their music. I think they really are, or were, I think I've read a couple of times they're not a band anymore. I might be misremembering some comments. They're a band that really is unique in every aspect of the word. I don't think anybody else is like them, combines the ideas that they do. They are hyper-prog, hyper-experimental. They experiment with everything from, you know, intonation to texture to timbre to tone to complexity to layering. It is a tough listen, I think, for most people, this song specifically. But I think the people who really dig it, and maybe they can sync up as far as mental state or emotional state, maybe they're just in the right mindset for it, I think it has the chance to be sort of a unique experience. Because, like I said, I don't think anyone else is going to deliver on the ideas that these guys do. With that said, it is not for me. I appreciate what they do. I appreciate their willingness to basically look at every rule for creating good music and saying we're going to do none of it. So much so to write what I would say, like I said with the chorus, a traditionally good rock song, and then purposefully, in a sense, destroy it and transform it into something that is difficult to listen to, that has intonation. I was going to say issues, but, you know, it works outside of intonation. It works outside of, you know, good mixing of layered instruments and just bucking every trend to take something that I would see as, you know, a really nice groovy section and making it just about right on the edge of unlistenable. Yeah, it's just, they give me a lot to think about, as does almost any experimental band. Same with stuff like Igor, anybody that really makes music that is out there, just basically bucking every trend and going their own road. You know, it always challenges my views of what good music is, as well as expanding my views of what music can be and what music can do, especially when your end goal is not to create a song that is palatable. And I think that's what these guys have done here. They've created a song that is artistically resonant, but not entirely musically palatable. And for that, I have to give them a bunch of props. It's just, it takes guts to go out of your way and make a song like this. But it seems to be true to them. They don't seem to compromise any of their ideas. And they, you know, they march to their own beat. So, yeah, that is the Mars Volta. Those are my thoughts on Tetragrammaton. And sort of Mars Volta as a whole, now that we've listened to a few of them, I did kind of sum up some of the things I've been thinking about this band. This is where you guys come in, though. Hit me up in the comments. Let me know what you thought of this track, if you enjoyed it or didn't, if there's anything that you agree with me on or disagree with me on, and if you have any context, seriously, or context. Yeah, that's the word I'm looking for. Yeah, if you have any context for this. Maybe just to give me some insight into where it fits in the album or what it means or the lyrics that I have no idea what he was saying, how any of this might fit together. Or interviews. I mean, if you have any words straight from the mouth of these guys about what this song is about or why they wrote it, I'd love to hear any of it. When you're done commenting, there's a description box if you'd like to check out any links adjacent to the channel, such as the Discord server or the Patreon community, any stuff like that. I'll be back tomorrow at 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 10 p.m. UTC. Golly, my nose is itchy. 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 10 p.m. UTC with the final video for this week's special selection. And then, of course, Saturday and Sunday, we'll do two more special selections. And then Monday is Gent Week. So I think we're going to have some people pretty excited about that. As a forward, though, little note, there will be no Periphery on Gent Week because I've listened to pretty much everything they've ever made. I'm a medium to large fan of theirs. So I can't really react to anything of theirs unless there's something brand new, like when we checked out Reptile when Hailstand dropped. So yeah. Until next time, remember to be critical, not cynical, of the music you enjoy. And have a fantastic morning, afternoon, or evening, whenever you choose to watch my videos.